Learn everything you need to know about HADR for Azure SQL Database, including a checklist and a recovery plan, this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Rajesh. Rajesh, thanks so much for coming on Data Exposed.
Thanks, Anna. Thanks for having me. It's a great pleasure to be on your show.
Great pleasure to have you on the show. I think it's been a while since you've been on the show, but today we're going to be talking about HADR for Azure SQL Database. And if you don't know what that means, you're about to find out. So first, can you tell us a little bit about like business continuity and what customers need to think about?
Sure. So in general, what happens is when we talk about SQL DB, high availability, and disaster recovery, there are a lot of concepts that customers get confused with. So my hope is at the end of this session, we break down what is the difference between what is business continuity and what are the three pillars that we think makes part of business continuity. Now, if you look at the deck, I'm currently sharing my deck here, we'll start with understanding what is business continuity. Then we'll dive into the three pillars, which is what I was talking about, availability, high availability, and disaster recovery. And the two takeaways for this presentation would be HADR checklist, where we provide a prescriptive guidance of what we think a customer should be following up, and an outage recovery guidance. And this is extremely helpful in the event of an outage, and then what should you do when an outage happens, so we don't have to panic during the time of an outage. Now, quickly touching upon business continuity. We all understand what business continuity is. These are all the procedures that enable a business to continue in the face of a disruption. And these disruptions could be human errors. We have seen this. There are customers who delete data accidentally and they want to go back. There are equipment failures, which is quite common in the public cloud. It's inevitable because of the nature of changes that we do, the software and hardware failures. And then there are natural disasters and other man-made disasters that happen as well. Now that we understand what business continuity is, let's jump right into the three pillars of business continuity. And this is pretty much what we were talking about, Anna, is one of the key messages that we want to send across to viewers is understanding the differences between these three. Right? Now, availability, when customer buys or provisions a SQL DB database, they are signing up for a service. I mean, they're paying for the service. So as a service provider, we guarantee that every database comes with its core resiliency and reliability, and that will protect it against any kind of failures that happen within the data center. Now, we also take automated backups. Consider this as one of the off-the-shelf feature. You provision a database, you get automated backups. So that will protect you for any of the accidental delete or any corruption that could, rare corruption that happens in our systems, right? And we also guarantee an industry-leading SLA of 4 nines, which means in a month, we guarantee an SLA of 4 minutes downtime. And if you breach it, then there's a process to talk to the service, customer support, and then ask for an SLA credit. Now, in business continuity, the two key terms that everybody understands in this world is RPO, which stands for Recovery Point Objective, which is pretty much the data loss. And because of the redundancy that we have across different layers, starting from the compute and the storage, we can guarantee a zero data loss for availability. And then for recovery downtime, which is our goal, is to make it to as zero as possible. And we have seen in cases where we don't get to go to zero, but our goal is to get to zero as much as possible, right? Now, jumping on to the next pillar, which is high availability. One of the key points that we want to send across is, this is something that has to be configured by customer. And what we mean by a customer configured high availability is, you turn on zone redundancy. In this case, the database becomes resilient to zonal failures. As you can see here, each region has multiple zones, and then each zone has multiple data centers. So in the event, an event is impacting one of the data center, your database will still be resilient to zonal failures. And this failovers that happen for a database when it is marked zone redundant is transparent applications. So the application won't even know as long as it's retrying. And what we do with zone redundancy is we go one level higher from 4 nines to a 4 nines and a 5. Now that we have multiple replicas, we are able to guarantee a high availability. Same goes with RPO, no data loss, and then recovery time objective, which is not close to zero, but it's sub-second. At times it's sub-second or takes few seconds depending on the service tier on which SQL DB is deployed on. Quickly touching upon the last part, which is the disaster recovery. And again, the key message is this is customer configured, understandable. And this is for redundancy. If you want redundancy across regions, let's say you have your deployments in East US and you want to make sure these deployments are redundant even if something goes wrong in the entire East US region, right? In that case, you would enable DR and then use one of these options, either the failover groups or geo-replication, or if not, the last option is having at least the geo-restore capability. The key difference here is RPO, which is the amount of data loss, is definitely greater than zero, or depending on the workload that runs on the primary. Since it's all asynchronous nature of data replication, there is some amount of latency between your primary and secondary, and that's what we call it. And recovery time objective, the downtime, is typically less than a minute. So what we have seen in our from our data is most of the failovers complete within less than a minute. And this picture shows the redundancy across regions. So you have a primary region, and then you have your secondary regions. There are two dimensions to think through when customers think about the three pillars. First dimension is price. Obviously, when you increase your, when you go from availability to high availability and DR, price goes up because you're adding higher redundancy. There's also a caveat because with premium and business critical high availability, it's free, high availability is included. So it's an absolute no-brainer to just turn on zone redundancy for business critical and premium. So that's about price. The other dimension is business continuity, which as it's self-explanatory, you go from left to right, you get a higher business continuity across the three pillars.
Got it. Okay, makes a lot of sense. So if I just summarize what I learned, like availability, that just comes, it's just part of the service. But if you need high availability, that's something as a customer you should configure. And the way we do that is with zone redundancy.
Yes.
Not zone redundancy of the backup, zone redundancy of
the
database.
Yes.
And then the third thing is disaster recovery. Again, this is customer configured, and this includes like your geo replication and your failover groups. It's basically spanning geos.
Exactly.
Okay, got it.
Yep, you summarized it very well, Anna. Thank you. All right, let's quickly look at it in a animation. So let's say in this case, you have one region, and we talk about, let's say, zone in a region. Each of this represents a data center. Now, the first pillar that we're talking about is availability. In this case, all the replicas will still be in within the same data center. They'll be spread across multiple fault domains and update domains, but you still are dealing with a deployment that's confined to one data center, right? Now, the moment you move to high availability, which is zone redundancy, we spread the replicas across zones, meaning your DB is resilient to zonal failures, which is what we have seen happen in public cloud, and it's inevitable that you will hit any kind of failure. So you need to make sure your DB is resilient to these kind of failures. And this applies to various service tiers. In this case, this is for a business critical. That's where you see four replicas. But the concepts apply even to hyperscale or general purpose as well, right? Now, if you jump into disaster recovery, you just replicate the deployment from one region to another region. You have a continuous data synchronization that goes on between your primary and secondary, right? So that's pretty much the whole availability, high availability, and DR in a nutshell.
Awesome. No, it makes a ton of sense. So I think, like, learned a lot about the three pillars. Would love to hear from your view, like, what are the tips and tricks? What do people need to go do today?
Got it. Yeah, that's a great question. And we have tried our best. I mean, what we have been trying to do to tell customers is we want, customers have been asking for a prescriptive guidance on what needs to happen. Now, what I've done is, in fact, create a quick checklist. I'll point a link to the doc. But one of the key takeaway that we want every customer to go away with is enable zone redundancy. So this is something that will protect their production database from any kind of failures within a zone. So your DB is absolutely resilient. You don't even notice something happened. It could be a power outage. It could be a storage cluster outage. Or it could be any kind of outages that's confined within a zone. And that's pretty much what happens in the public cloud. So that's first key takeaway. The other checklist point is enabling failover groups and then setting the failover policy to manual, which is customer managed. And the way to think about the failover policy is the moment you set the failover policy to manual, which means this is managed by you, and you get to control when the failover happens. So you don't have to rely on a service provider to trigger failovers, which is what is a neat benefit that you get. I mean, you get to decide based on your business continuity plan and then your criticality or applications, you get to failover as and when you deem that the availability has been impaired, right? And here's a short link that takes you to a detailed checklist on prescriptive guidance on high availability and disaster recovery. That goes a lot more in detail on what we all have covered there.
Awesome. That's great. Any other tips or tricks folks should think about?
There's one more link that I want to share now that we have talked about the checklist. We have also published some prescriptive guidance on what should customers do in the event of an outage. So that way, you are well prepared. What's the flow looks like? Like, you start from where do you look at an outage, and then what do you do during an outage? You start with a failover, which is no data loss, and then eventually you upgrade that to a forced failover where there is some amount of data loss. And this link takes you right exactly to that document page.
Amazing. Rajesh, thanks so much for coming on. This is such an important topic for our customers, so I'm really glad we were able to get you on the show. To our viewers, you might want to bookmark this link we just showed just in case you need it. We'll also put a link to this and the checklist in the description for you to learn more. If you like this episode, go ahead and give it a like, leave us a comment, let us know what you think, if you have any questions, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.